are some of the earliest of Newcastle, and several quayside premises have been captured by the photographer. They're photographs which clearly reveal the wealth of building that existed, the richness of the townscape that was lost, and the tragedy of its loss. In the 19th century, it was usual for shop assistants to be taken on as apprentices for 7 years, during which time they had to observe the strict rules laid down by indenture. Thomas Kidd, a retail and wholesale draper with premises at 110 the side, had one such apprentice, a particularly successful apprentice, who, in 1838 with a partner, opened a drapery shop in Market Street. His name was Emerson Muscombe Bainbridge. From the start, Bainbridge's shop was different from those round about it. Among the innovations that he introduced into his new shop were a number of items that we now take for granted, like the abolition of bargaining for goods and the practice of ticketing each item with the price. There's no evidence that Bainbridge actually invented these practices, but he was in the very vanguard of their use. Even more radical was an advert which appeared in the Newcastle Courant on the 1st of June 1838, which specifically mentions the hosiery department and the silk department. The idea must have developed quickly, because by 1849 there were 23 separate sets of takings, which must make it one of the very first department stores, not only in the Northeast, but in the whole world. The partnership dissolved in 1841, and Bainbridge traded on his own until 1842, when he went into partnership with a cousin, John Bell Muscombe. This lasted until 1851, when Bainbridge began trading as Bainbridge & Co. In 1886, the firm introduced a pneumatic cash carrier, claimed at the time to be the only one in England. Invented by John Newton, a foreman with Henry Walker and Sons, the system proved a quicker link between the sales counter and the cashier. Previously, the money had been carried by cash boys. The customer's bill and cash were now placed in a small box, which was conveyed to the cashier's department along a closed tube by compressed air, supplied by an Otto gas engine. These systems survived into the late 1960s or early 1970s. Bainbridge's became a limited company in 1897 and remained so until it became part of the John Lewis Partnership in 1953. Over this long period, the store expanded dramatically, with entrances in Market Street, Granger Street and the Big Market, until 1976, when the business was transferred to the new Eldon Square Shopping Centre.
I have very pleasant memories because we had a jolly good clientele where I worked. Customers were very good. They were rather demanding, but if you gave them good service, then they appreciated that, and quite often they would be most appreciative, and sometimes at Christmas time you would get a little present from them.
Many other famous Newcastle stores began to establish themselves about the same time as Bainbridge. Robson & Sons, cabinet makers and upholsterers, started in 1835 in Northumberland Street. Reed's the Jewellers had been going since 1778, but they opened new premises in Grey Street in 1844, where they stayed until they moved to these quite splendid new premises in Blackett Street in 1906. Splendid enough outside, but inside it's a jewel box of a shop, the absolute model of what we feel a jeweller should look like.
Not many people had watches then. Most of us have watches today. And the public clocks in the Granger Market and other public clocks in the town, some of the church clocks, all gave Greenwich time. And the reason for that was they were slave clocks. They didn't have their own works, they didn't have their own movement. Reed's, the jewellers in Blackett Street, had a wonderful master clock connected to Greenwich by radio. And from Blackett Street to all these shops by wire, which the GPO had laid, And all the clocks on the Granger Market clock always gave you Greenwich Mean Time, so that's where you look before struggling home with all your shopping.
Amos Atkinson, the shoe shop, was another firm which began in Newcastle. It moved to Northumberland Street in 1892, though the feature for which their shop was most famous, the beautiful plasterwork or pargeting on the outside walls, was not added until much later, as we shall see. Coxons, the drapers who were later to be taken over by Binns, started in 1849. And Chapman's, the famous Siesta furniture shop, began in North Shields in 1847, before starting the leaps around Newcastle, which finally landed them in their present store on Market Street. And the process continued, so that by the turn of the century, many Tyneside favourites were firmly established. Scott and Son, the umbrella shop. Stewart's Tea. Tyler, Boots and Shoes. Inman's Stores, who were to become one of the early branches of Boots. They were real shops, these, justifiably proud of their appearances and their window displays. Glendenning, the wine merchant of Blackett Street, is a wonderful example of the beauty of which they were capable. The interior, with its dark, polished mahogany counters, display cases and shelves, its gas lighting and its engraved glass, beautiful. Jackson the Tailor began about 1900 in Clayton Street and became well known for the famous 30-shilling suit and the motto, small profits and quick returns. Marks and Spencer opened the Penny Bazaar in the Granger Market in 1895, in a store which is still remarkably unaltered today and is probably the earliest M&S still in operation anywhere. But in Newcastle terms, the most famous arrival of all in these years occurred on the 23rd of March 1882, when John James Fenwick opened an exclusive mantle shop at No. 5 Northumberland Street, before moving later to numbers 37 and 39, two doctor's residences, which were to grow into the famous department store of today. When the new extension of 1913 opened, 20,000 people were reported to have passed through the doors on the first day.
I wonder how many people pass through in a single day nowadays. This is the extension of 1913, built of ceramic tiles, splendidly Baroque in style, typical Edwardian architecture. But if you sneak around the corner into the lane at the side, you can still find, painted cream on the ground floor perhaps, but the stonework of that original doctor's house.
20,000 people. But no wonder, because by this time Fenwick's and Bainbridge's too had become the fashion leaders of the area, and they were to remain so for many years to come, and their fashion catalogues and advertisements reflect the changing styles during their long periods of existence. These, of course, were great years for advertising. By the turn of the century, many firms were producing well-illustrated catalogues to advertise their goods and services. The introduction of picture postcards enabled shops to advertise cheaply and efficiently. The trams and trolleybuses too provided an ideal platform for advertising, and in the 1920s the tram bill adverts for Fenwick's were a famous sight in the city. These adverts are now preserved in the Tyne and Weir archives on West Blandford Street. But in the midst of all of this increasing glitter and opulence, there was still a place in Newcastle for the individual street trader. And many of these colourful characters made ideal subjects for the enthusiastic amateur photographers of the time. Shoelace Tommy was photographed about 1880. Mrs. Richardson is captured for posterity, selling her fruit outside the Central Station in 1900. An old organ grinder poses in Northumberland Street, where today licensed and unlicensed traders still ply their noisy wares.
Thank you.
But such traders were, as they still are, way outside the mainstream of the shopping world, because the early 20th century was a time for leisure and an age of real service to those shoppers who could afford it.
We built up our own connection of customers, and we had our own little books with customers' names and addresses in, the type of shoes that they wore, the sizes and everything. And before even the sales started, we used to get our own list out and collect these shoes together, and we used to send them out to the customers. No, not being asked to, we would send them out. And the customers would say, come in and say, jolly good, thank you very much. We thank you for keeping us in mind. So we had a little connection of our own. I don't know whether it was correct. You know, possibly some people might say, well, look, you know, they were giving preferential treatment, you see. But, you see, you had to build up goodwill, and which is what we did in those days. It wasn't the first time that the customer came into the shop that paid our wages. It was the second and the third and the fourth time, kept coming back because they were given good service.
Shopping was seen as a pleasure, with the emphasis on customer service and comfort. There were efficient delivery services to the home by horse-drawn carts.
Your tea, madam.
Errand boys on bicycles and delivery boys with their baskets. Even the First World War failed to stop the flow because it enabled firms to link their advertising with patriotic gestures, such as war charities and war savings. Bainbridges were even called in to provide army uniforms when the official supply of khaki in the area ran out. Some firms had to petition the local military authorities to release their best assistance from war trade.